I would just like to start with some participation, if you don't mind. I'm going to ask anyone who has ever experienced an error, an adverse event, or a mistake during their career in medicine to put up their hand. Okay, let's keep them up for a second, just for a laugh here. Okay, of the people that have their hands up, how many experienced that during the course of their training? Okay, so we still have quite a few people. So of the people who still have their hands up, who's been in practice quite a long time? Is anyone willing to volunteer? Let's see. Well, you get, hey, this is learner-centered. You get to define it, right? So who feels like they've been in practice for a long time? It's still everyone. Okay, I'm going to pick on you just because I saw your hand go up first. I'm not going to ask you to tell me about what happened. But what I want to ask you is, why do you remember it?
Because it bothered me.
That's beautiful distillation. You know, I think what I really want to point out here is that errors are an extraordinary opportunity for learning, durable learning, extraordinary learning. And I think we need to capture those moments. Our first concern, of course, is patient safety, patient-centered care. That goes without saying, but I'm going to ask us to just turn the lens a little bit today and look at the opportunity for teaching in these events. I'll go ahead and tell you one. In 1991, I think, at McGill, I was a medical student, deep in the background in the operating room during a kidney transplant conveniently at 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning. And I had a surgeon say to me, we need a little suction here, Mike. And so I reached through this pack of people and put the suction into the fossa and immediately heard a little surgical clip making its way down the pipe as I watched some blood start to fill the surgical field. So the surgeon looked at me, and I can still see his face. I can still hear his tone of voice. I can still feel that moment vividly. What is it, 22 years later? And he looked at me and he said, "Come on, Mike, you got to work with me, not against me." I think if you can plant that sentence in my head to last for 22 years, I think that tells you how powerfully we can capture these moments and teach people. I have to make a couple of disclosures. First of all, I have nothing to disclose. I have no financial affiliation with any information presented in this topic. I do want to say a couple of things. I've collected three cases for us to review after many years of experience in multiple settings. And these are pretty dramatic cases. But they've been carefully anonymized and adjusted so that I am not violating anyone's privacy here. I also just want to acknowledge a book that I was forced to read during History of Medicine at McGill a long, long time ago called Forgive and Remember that actually creates the taxonomy of errors that I'm gonna refer to here. So this is what I hope to do in our session. I want to define errors. I want to talk about what that means. I want to talk about the three cases I mentioned. I want to propose that we learn to frame errors and then teach, really capture that moment. And then I want to briefly review the medical legal aspects involved in errors that occur in the teaching setting. And I suppose one extra disclosure, I do not speak on behalf of the CMPA, but I did discuss these cases with them to get a little guidance about how to review this topic. Okay, so let's just talk about definition. I love this one. This is from the former chair of the American Board of Family Medicine. He said, "A medical error is anything that happens in my office that shouldn't have happened and that I absolutely do not want to have happen again." I think that's a very nice definition of error. I think it's really worth pausing for a second and just thinking about this notion of definition, because I don't think anyone really agrees on what an error, an adverse event is, a mistake. There's a lot of room to define this for ourselves. I've heard another definition that says any adverse event that occurs in the course of clinical care, whether it's apparent or evident to the patient or not. I think that's an important little piece here. There are these events that occur that the patient never becomes aware of, and they're every bit as real and they're every bit as important as those that the patient is aware of. I put the word rare there. Does everyone feel comfortable with rare on this slide? Are they rare? Okay, so this is a really, really difficult factor to pin down. I think most of us are aware of the Institute of Medicine paper in 1999, To Err is Human. There's an extraordinary paper that said between 44,000 and 98,000 people die in the United States per year from preventable medical error. It was a stunning figure to be published and very alarming. And it's led to big, big system changes. We've had a similar study in Canada in 2004, the Adverse Events Report, that suggested there may be 24,000 people who die in Canada per year from preventable medical error. And if you scale it up by 10 for the population differential, we're not even doing as well as the United States was in 1999. So I think it's hard to legitimately put the word rare here, but I would point out we know nothing about the training environment. The literature is thin and it's methodologically flawed. A lot of it is on case report, and there's this issue of definition. I'm sorry, not case report, on self-report. There's also this problem in defining what an error, what a preventable event, what an adverse event, what a mistake is. So we really don't know what these kind of numbers are in the training environment. But I would say that all of us here are part of the system that's meant to absorb errors and protect patients and prevent these events from occurring. Now, undeniably, they do occur, but I would like to believe that we're part of a layer that does make this a little more rare in our setting than in typical medical practice. I'm going to move on to the first case. Are there any questions at this point? Okay, what I want you to do is picture yourself as this physician. You're the physician now teaching an extraordinary resident, okay? This is a young woman who was previously a physiotherapist, and she's decided to come back and retrain as a family physician, and she's outstanding. Her knowledge of musculoskeletal medicine is amazing, and she's just come off an orthopedics rotation, okay? So she knows what she's doing. At the end of her, or during the course of her orthopedics rotation, she's had the opportunity to participate in a few intra-articular steroid injections. And you've been a very effective faculty member in opening her rotation by asking her what her learning objectives are. One of her learning objectives is to be able to conduct an intra-articular steroid injection independently. And you want to support her in this learning objective, okay? Now you just happen to have a patient who's 41 years old with early onset osteoarthritis of the left knee, who's tried oral medications and topical medications and physiotherapy, and is really loath to take any more oral medications at this point. And after careful counseling, she's elected to have a steroid injection. And you think, what a perfect moment. I'm going to allow the resident to work with me on this case. Okay? So you're in your office, and you thinking of the resident's learning objective and how you're going to fulfill that, you set the resident up to do this procedure independently. You enter the room and the resident has been talking to the patient about what's going to happen. The equipment is all set. You're standing in the background letting this unfold and you're called away for a phone call. Okay, you leave the room, you complete your phone call, you re-enter the room, and the resident's beaming. The needle is out. The patient said, "That was incredible. I hardly felt a thing." Everyone's happy. You're making small talk. You're cleaning up the Mayo stand. And you find this. Okay. Does everyone see what's happened here? Okay. Your resident has now inadvertently injected 150 milligrams of Depo-Provera into this patient's knee. Okay. So we have an opportunity here. Now, I'm just going to say again that the care of the patient is paramount here. That's the most important thing, of course. But I'm going to shift the lens a little bit and ask us to just reflect on this as a teaching experience, okay? So what I'm going to ask you to do, as I mentioned earlier, is I'm going to ask you to try and frame this and then teach from it, okay? So this is my proposed frame. It's a three-step process. The first thing you need to do is define the morbidity, because sometimes that's unclear. Sometimes we don't know the impact of what's happened, and sometimes what's happened is not particularly significant for the patient and allows us complete freedom to turn to the teaching moment. So can anyone define the morbidity here? It's a good point. We don't know. You don't, there isn't a case series of Depo Provera in the knee. Okay, so this is a really challenging one. Well, okay, thank you for raising that, because I'm going to throw a wrinkle in here. Good birth control. I'm going to throw a wrinkle in here. This patient's 41, and she's on clomiphene. Okay? So now what's the morbidity? Okay, undeniably, one piece of this is there's loss of trust, or loss of faith, or distress associated with this. Even if we're lucky, and the clinical pharmacologists tell us that the impact is very small and there's that it's very unlikely to affect her fertility in the 90 days, in the following 90 days. Nonetheless, there has been a significant injury to this patient in loss of trust. I think that's really worth recognizing. Okay, I'm going to move on to the second part of the frame. I think we need to define this in terms of what type of error is it. And I'm going to propose that there are three typical types of errors. Technical errors, normative errors, and knowledge-based errors. And I'll go through each of them as I go through the cases. So this is a technical error. This is something that, it's much like when I pulled the surgical clip off. It's just a simple technical error. And I think when you define it as a technical error, it influences the way you're going to teach from this. I want to just ask you then to step to reflecting on, are there individual and are there system factors involved in this event? Just think through on your own, are there things that apply only to the individual, and are there system fixes that we should think about with this case? Okay? So we've framed this now. We've stepped back and said, okay, well, I need to quickly define what the morbidity is, but I do need to keep in mind that there's a serious trust issue that's happened here, minimum. I've defined this as a technical error, and I've contemplated individual and system factors. So I'm gonna say pretty confidently that with almost all technical errors, these are self-correcting. It's very rare when this happens that someone doesn't reflect and think about it and hold it in their head and think about how it could have been done better. And personally, I don't think there's a lot of valuable teaching in going over the event for the resident, walking them through where the error happened. Does anyone doubt that there's tremendous reflection and likely self-correction in an event like this? I think when I had been told I should work with the surgeon and not against the surgeon, it probably would have been helpful to give me a little technique. You know, a little lighter on your hand there, Mike. You know, don't lean in. I don't know. I think each case deserves some reflection about a little tip we could offer. But I think we do need to trust the phenomenon of self-correction in events like these. In terms of individual actions, is there anything you can think of that you would that you might recommend for the resident? Yeah, so it seems kind of self-evident, right? Read the label, but this happens. So I think this is a great opportunity to review the importance of a safety pause. The right patient, the right medication, the right joint. Stop. Pause. Count it out. Look. Read. Not necessarily to say every time you pick up a vial, read it, but to create a habit of reflection and caution and a pause. But personally, I think that might be helpful in individual action in this. System action, this is the ACGME, the American Accreditation Council on Graduate Medical Education. This is one of their core competencies for residents. They want them to develop an awareness and responsiveness to the larger context or to the system issues here. There's big system issues here, in my opinion. Why do we have two medicines, both with the word depot, packaged in identical sized vials? It's so obvious that in an alphabetical order, they're going to sit side by side, depot, depot. There's a serious system issue there. And I think this case might give your resident an opportunity to comprehend system issues and their impact on individual actions. Any thoughts on this case?
With the first time, well, this is the first time they're injecting, when you've been doing a lot, you look for different colored vials and so on. Mm-hmm. But when it's the first time, there's no reference point for what the vial looked like anyways.
You're exactly right. You and I would probably recognize the wrong color right away. It's, whoops. But someone doing it the first time might not.
Yeah, there's a very close parallel to cytokine with the different without the red and the blue, and the color of the percentage is red sometimes versus blue with the inhibitors red versus blue. So they're just another example of that kind of thing that you need to make people aware of.
It's a great point. It happens everywhere. The eye drawer in Burns Lake in the ER had the midriatic and the topical anesthetic in identically shaped triangular packages, only differentiated by a tiny written text on the back of the package. It's terrible.
You talk about this resident being self-correcting.
Yeah.
If you need everyone to be paying attention and be sort of thinking about this, because my concern is that all they're going to
do. That's a good point. That's
and that, you know, if we say, well, they're self-correcting, so we don't need to pay any attention to that.
Okay, that's a great point. In fact, people are more likely to make an error in the 30 days after an error has occurred because they perseverate. But I don't think it's a valuable piece of teaching to say this resident, you really don't want to inject Epo Provera into the knee, so, you know, you really want to be careful.
Wait.
Yeah, yeah, I'm sorry. I think that definitely needed clarification. You're right. I think what I want to plant in that resident's brain is you need a habit that is going to stop a similar event that's unrelated from happening in the future.
So the question that I have here was, who's made the error?
Sorry, I couldn't hear that.
The question is, who made the error?
Yeah.
What?
Because from my perspective, if this was the first, no matter how good the rest is, all the experience that we had, if this was the first injection that she was doing under supervision, then there should be some explicit process that should be outlined, that even if it was a phone call that I actually attended to, that she would have actually went.
Yeah, it's a great point. So in my notes for this, under individual actions, when I was reflecting on this, I thought you have to reflect individually yourself about your office process. Should she have had an assistant? Should I have vetted, or if I'm in the role, should the preceptor have vetted what was on her Mayo stand? Yes, you're right. I think as an individual action, we have to reflect on our role and what role we played in this.
Yeah, at the same point, you know, was it the right time to step out to take a phone call?
Right. All right, so, I'm sorry.
So what kind of damage control did you do for the patient?
Well, thankfully this wasn't my case. But I think what I would do is turn this back over to the group and say, what would you do? Damage control is an interesting phrase. What I would want to do is try and disclose and counsel in the most compassionate and effective way that I possibly could. Don't mean to bias the group, but what would people do?
Just bring it back to the teachable moment. I think it's an incredible opportunity as a teachable moment, right? Mm-hmm. So the risk is really relatively low, presumably, relatively low, like in the fertility thing, you know, think about that. But use it as an opportunity to say, okay, what are we going to do about this? So when do you realize it? So how do you realize it after the patient's already left? Versus if you actually realize it right at that time. So, and then depending on the acuity and things, they take, ask the resident what they're going to do.
Yeah.
Are they completely freaked out and kind of unfunctional? Or is a stellar resident, it's a not a huge opportunity. what are you going to do about it?
Mm-hmm.
And see how they think it through. So I would take that approach, presumably.
I probably would start off by role modeling how to apologize.
There you go. Beautiful. I think both points are great. I think you have an opportunity to take the resident somewhere that they wouldn't anticipate they'd go, to learn how to handle this, how to disclose, how to be compassionate, how to admit to the patient, which is your ethical duty, that something has gone wrong here. And I think there's great learning on that element, for sure. So I think, depending on the maturity, the comfort, the emotional state of the resident in that moment, you have an opportunity to mobilize the resident's ability to help with this case.
And really, Mike, I think that this resident that you described her is at risk in the fact that this is probably a perfectionist, very hard on herself, and this could be devastating if it's not handled correctly.
I think you're right. Absolutely. So I'm going to move on to case two. This is just a transition slide, and I was certain this was an error, but it wasn't. This is bacon on a maple donut in a donut shop. So I was, yes it was. Yeah, one of my sons had just finished playing hockey and we were sitting in the donut shop next to the rink and I thought, is that an error? And I got my camera out and I took it. And then we sat and had coffee and watched people empty this tray. People just came, oh, the maple bacon donuts are ready. Anyway, so it's hard to find an illustration of an error in a slide, but I thought that was pretty close. Okay, I'm going to move on to case two. This is a fascinating case to me. This is a 30-year-old woman who's 6 months postpartum. She's coming to see you in follow-up of treatment with sertraline for postpartum anxiety, maybe depression. This is a patient who has a daughter at home. She's previously worked as a fundraiser for the SIDS Foundation, and she knows SIDS inside out. And she's developed a debilitating anxiety about leaving her newborn baby to sleep at night. She's been sleepless for nights. She's had a terrible time. And she came to you seeking help, and you treated her with sertraline. She's come back to see you and has been doing quite well. She's quite happy with the result. But she's developed the side effect of reduced libido. Okay? You have a resident working with you who you brief on the topic and you send the resident in to see her. Okay? The resident comes back to you. He's actually, you know what? I'm sorry. This is an important point. He's a student at this point. He comes back to you and he describes the situation. He says that she was in a hurry to leave. He's told her that it's fine to leave because she's doing well on the medicine. He's encouraged her to stay on it for one more month before making a decision about this side effect. And he wants your approval for what he's done. So you listen to it and you think, well, you've taken quite a good history. I think you've essentially done what I would have counseled. It's unfortunate the patient's left without me having had a chance to say hello, but you approve the care and the patient is gone. Now the patient comes back a month later to see you alone. The student's no longer with you. And you were absolutely stunned to hear her say what the student told her. So this is a very reliable patient. In fact, she's the daughter of an esteemed colleague of yours. Okay? And she tells you that she's very uncomfortable telling you this, but she says, as you're wrapping up the visit, I'm really uncomfortable, but I want to tell you I was a little shocked by a couple of things that your student said to me last time. He said to me that he and his wife had had crazy sex until they had had a kid, and that they had tried everything at least once. He also said to her that he hadn't really had anything that he would call worthwhile sex with his wife for 2 years since their son was born. And then he thought her husband was being a bit of a hound dog, and that she should continue to take the medicine. Okay? Significant adverse event. So I think this is a great opportunity to reflect, first of all, what's the morbidity? What would you describe as the morbidity in this case? By the way, she's doing much better on the sertraline. The side effect has attenuated. She's doing very well. And this is an incidental, by the way. What's the morbidity? Sorry? Yeah, I would call this a deprofessionalization experience. She's been into the office and had a stunning experience that bears no relation to how I would practice medicine. I'm horrified that it's happened in my office. Any other morbidity that you can think of?
She won't ever want to see a student.
Yeah, yeah, you're right. It's going to interfere with the training environment in your office, absolutely. And if this has happened with her, you do have to wonder what other patients have been impacted and have just been too embarrassed to say something to you.
I think trust. I would be concerned if my family doctor left someone without seeing me, without knowing that there was an issue.
You're absolutely right. It erodes her trust in me as well. In me, the system, the clinic, our profession. To me, this is a very, very significant event, and I think it perfectly captures normative errors. So a normative error is an error that occurs when a student, a resident, a trainee has not adopted the professional standards that we expect of them at their level of development. It's a failure in the conscientious discharge of one's duty. I think the easiest filter when I'm framing these is to think, could I ever have done this? You know, could I have made a mistake with the vial? Yes. But could I say this to a patient? Absolutely not. That to me defines a normative error. So let's just talk about individual and systems issues here. Think about it for a second. Are these self-correcting? Okay. Are there systems issues? Yeah, so when I'm going to teach on this, my first thought is, I would go back to the word damage control. I need to establish behavioral guidelines for someone who does not seem to understand the behavioral guidelines that they should have adopted already. And I also need to know that I need the full support of the system to back me up in this. I know that there's a system problem in the fact that this student has arrived in my office with behaviors like this. Now, sometimes normative errors occur because of events in a student or a resident's life. And they may be transient, and they may get better. But many times that's not the case. And these are the signs that someone is headed for the back of the college quarterly, as someone put it. Now, in my mind, that should be a never event. This is wrong site surgery. We should never graduate someone headed for the back of the college quarterly knowingly. Okay, so I don't trust these to be self-correcting. I do think that there are significant system issues to contemplate. How did that student end up in my office? And I think you need to escalate these cases immediately. You need the support of the system in cases like this. I would not hesitate to notify the residency director, the dean of the medical school, the site director, the course coordinator. You need backup. These are serious events. Now, if the residency director finds that this student has a substance abuse issue, and they enter treatment, this may be quite remediable. If the student, the resident, has a marriage in distress, this may get better, but you can't trust it. You have to address this. These must be never events in my mind. Any thoughts on that?
We always need to remember that that's one side of the story. Mm-hmm. And so it's easy to kind of get very distraught.
Okay, I think that's a great point. I'll give you a different example just briefly. And I'm sorry, I've got to be careful with time here, but I do want to tell you a different story. I was at a meeting where an anesthesiologist mentioned a trainee. Well, I'm gonna change the case slightly, but the elements are the same. Disposed of a sharp in a garbage, fished it out and put it in the sharps bucket. And when the anesthesiologist said, hey, you gotta be careful with that, they said it never happened, despite being watched, okay? The anesthesiologist responded, sort of smiled, like, it's weird, wow, odd. That, to me, I think, is a normative error. Lying to you directly is a normative error that mandates that we take that absolutely seriously. There's a principle in moral development in children that children are often more interested in the outcome of an action in judging its moral weight than they are in the intentions of the actor. The classic is the child who thinks it's much worse to have accidentally knocked 10 plates off of a counter than it is to have climbed up against your parents' advice and broken one plate. By about 10 or 12, that moral development advances to a more mature level. But if you think about the way we judge errors, we often use the same moral reasoning of the young child. We say the big bad event is the one we really want to go after, when really what we should be after is the intention. So your point is really important, but I think minimum you need to explore this really carefully.
Yeah, absolutely.
I kind of embedded a little fact in there that this is the daughter of an esteemed colleague. This is a really trustworthy person who is really uncomfortable telling me this. The likelihood that this isn't... Anyway, needless to say...
Can I just interject from that? Uh-huh. It doesn't matter.
Yeah,
it's
you're right.
Perception.
You're right.
And that's what the patient heard. And so I think while it is true what Cam is saying, the reality is the teaching point for that patient is you'll be judged on what the patient heard. And how many times do we not end up having CMPA involved? Not because our intention, but because what the patient heard. The communication breakdown is so important.
Absolutely. I think that's a great point. This is another error. People who know it, I don't need to. Performance. Well, big surprise. Performance enhancing drugs. Okay. Okay. Case three. This. Now you're working with a first year resident who comes to you and tells you that he's just seen a 36-year-old male with stereotypical facial pain, fevers, and headache. This is kind of a new patient to you. You've seen them once in the past for a medication refill. The student's telling you the story in the hall, and they say, this guy's in a real rush. He's heading for his honeymoon in Mexico. He's got all the features of sinusitis. He had previous endoscopic sinus surgery. He's very familiar with it. He's saying, look, I just want antibiotics. I don't want this to wreck my honeymoon. You and the resident have a discussion about the use of antimicrobials in the treatment of bacterial and viral rhinosinusitis. And ultimately, you agree to the resident giving this patient a sample of some moxifloxacin to have with him on his honeymoon because he's running for the airport right now. Okay? So you're horrified to find that when he gets back from Mexico, he reports this to you. The medication that he refilled with you was Coumadin, which he takes for protein C deficiency. In Mexico, he was seen in the ER with torrential epistaxis. He had an INR of 12. He had nasal packing. He had blood products, and he was admitted to the hospital. Okay? When you discuss it with the resident said, I thought doxycycline didn't interact with Coumadin. He said, it's moxifloxacin. What's happened here? Well, let's pause for a second. The morbidity, this is really significant. Exposure to blood products, cost, discomfort, trust, hospitalization, the damage to his honeymoon. Technical, normative, knowledge-based? I think there's components of technical and knowledge-based errors here. You know, there was something the resident failed to do in acquiring the knowledge from the patient that they were on Coumadin. And if they did know they were on Coumadin, they didn't have the knowledge to really carefully contemplate the potential interaction. If they contemplated the interaction, they didn't recognize the interaction between moxifloxacin and Coumadin. Are there individual or system issues that would allow us to teach?
All this rushing around examples.
Rushing, say that again.
Everyone's rushing.
There you go. Well, that's when these things happen. So, are these self-correcting, knowledge-based errors? Let's just say the student didn't know that medicine interacted with Coumadin, or antibiotics interacted with Coumadin. Is that a self-correcting error? Usually. But that student needs to prove to me that they are going to self-correct it. I need to start exploring for holes in their knowledge base. I need to explore that they are sufficiently motivated to fill those holes. Are there system actions in this case? I think sample closets. Sample closets are a disaster. That's how these things happen. Yeah, the pharmacist would have stopped this, right? Or the pharmacist would have alerted you. So I think there's system issues here related to the sample closet and our relationship with the pharmaceutical industry. There may be system issues whether you're using an EMR or not. If you're using an EMR and you use a sample closet and you enter that drug, you might get a Coumadin warning. So maybe you're not using an EMR. I think this illustrates, though, the difference between a knowledge error and a normative error. Obviously, the student didn't disregard the interaction between these medicines. So let's just briefly talk about the medical legal aspects. So, disclosure, everyone knows it, it's worth saying aloud. This is an absolute ethical duty. We cannot escape the duty of disclosure. When something goes wrong, whether it's had an impact on the patient or not, they deserve to know. Okay? We have apology legislation in British Columbia, and it's been in place since 2006 that provides you some medical legal protection in the event of an apology made to a patient after an adverse medical event. Which case do you think provides the biggest medical legal exposure to the preceptor? Sorry? Last one, number three. Any other thoughts? Okay, as I said, I don't speak on behalf of the CMPA, but they, when I spoke to the advisor from CMPA, they said case two was the most perilous, the normative error, and I was delighted to hear that. They said, if you have legitimately judged your resident or trainee to have the requisite skill to provide the service or make the decision or do the procedure that they have done under your supervision, they are responsible for the outcome. Now that's important, because if you have just said, oh, well, you can go and do it without actually examining their capacity to perform that medical act, you are still on the hot seat. But there is a transfer of that medical legal responsibility to the resident when you have passed it through that filter. I was delighted to hear that they said case two was the one they were most worried about, because they said, when you have a significant normative problem with a trainee, a student, a resident, and ultimately a physician, sometimes the case will be tracked back looking for signs that someone could have done something sooner. I call these students black swans. The vast majority of students and residents I've worked with in my career have been the best of the best. They're extraordinary people, and occasionally a black swan comes through the system. And we need to be aware of it, we need to be unemotional about it, and we need to deal with it. So, and if we don't, not only are there ethical consequences, there are also potentially medical legal consequences. So,
what's the apology legislation? What specifically is that? Is there some protection based on that?
Yeah, it's an interesting thing. It's the idea that we should feel comfortable in apologizing to patients, which many people aren't because of their perceived fear of the medical legal ramifications of saying, I'm sorry.
And so it essentially means to do it without prejudice?
That's right. Okay. That's right. The CMPA on their website says, be careful, though. Before you apologize, you ought to call them and tell them what you're going to say. And again, I'm not speaking on behalf of the CMPA, but I think it's 9 of the provinces now have apology legislation in place, and ours came into place in 2006. And it was designed to immunize you against the risk so that you could authentically say, I'm so sorry. In any of these cases, my first instinct is to say to the patient, I'm so sorry. But all of us feel a little restrained in that.
I was just doing one of the hospital courses on mental error, and they talked about that, and they said there is a somewhat of a distinction if you do want to say that you're sorry that this has happened and that this has affected them, but you also don't want to say that I'm sorry, this is my fault.
That's exactly what the CMPA website says, and I think that's a really important point, but it makes me feel a little uncomfortable because you end up saying, I'm sorry you felt this way. I'm sorry you felt feel the way that you feel. Yeah, which doesn't feel like an apology.
Well, you can frame it, I'm sorry that this wrong, that this medication
was injected.
I think
you're right.
It's just somewhat
slighted. I think if I was in this situation with this case, I think I would stop at, I'm so sorry.
Sorry, for case two, why don't we hear? Because I like to think if I'm in the room reviewing patients with the student, and then I said, okay, Mike, or whatever, you know, please explain what you're going to do and how to deal with the side effects with this medication. I start to, when you're in the room with the student in case two, if he starts to spew it up, you know, these are common side effects, it'll probably go away. You know, I remember when my wife and well, Andy just started off, and you know, unprofessional comment came out. What would you recommend to how to deal with it at the time? Obviously, that needs to be put to a stop right away.
What a great question. I suspect that a student like this would never make that statement in front of me. But if they did, I would interrupt. And I would say to the patient, I am so sorry. I need to speak to the student privately for a moment. I would take the student out and I would say, what you've just done is called a normative error. That is not a conscientious discharge of your duties. You have not adopted the professional standards that I expect of someone working in my office. Now, you and I need to go in and disclose to the patient that I've recognized that and what we want to do to fix it. I think that's what I would do. That's off the top of my head.
This happens to me quite a bit because I do sexual medicine and sexual pain, and I actually have no problems stopping this dude and actually saying, this is so-and-so, how do you feel right now?
Great.
And I just stop that statement and I'll say, how does, you know, so-and-so just said something, how do you feel? And she'll say, I feel like totally embarrassed or ashamed or I'm angry. And I say, yes. And I say, I think, you know, that the way so-and-so said that or was inappropriate, apologize. And then we'll move on from that. But I think it's really important for the student to hear the reaction, like at that moment, what they have said to the patient and how it makes the patient feel. Even if you decide to interrupt, go out, and then come back in, you have to, at that point, say, how do you feel?
That's why Leslie's...
I think that's the learning point to the patient.
That's why you're a role model to me. That's true. I mean, that's far better than what I said. I would completely agree. I think that's a perfect way to handle it. So just to close out, we defined errors. We reviewed our three cases and hopefully provided you with a frame. We talked about how to teach effectively from this. And I hope I briefly but effectively talked about the medical legal aspects of these cases. So thanks so much. I really appreciate the time.